Leonard Bernstein is, in my opinion, a lunatic. I hate him because he smokes like a chimney. And he's a lunatic because no one could possibly live long with the kind of schedule that he imposes upon himself.
In my highly advanced years now, I'm beginning to feel the strain, and I think, well, maybe some of those pestiferous critics who complained all through the years that I was a jack of all trades, master of none, whatever it was. Sometimes I have a moment of weakness, which I say, well, maybe they're beginning to be right. Maybe it's time that I stopped all this nonsense and once and for all settled down and wrote music.
This is John Amis with a Talking About Music specially devoted to Leonard Bernstein. I must say, working and smoking too much or not, he has, thank goodness, lived almost twice as long as Mozart. And come to think of it, Mozart was also a composer who wrote for theatre, church, concert and ballroom. He didn't go around conducting other people's music like Bernstein, but both were prodigious pianists. There was popular music in Mozart's time, but nothing quite like the musical of today and the jazz world. OK, Bernstein is no Mozart, but he is a quite phenomenal musician. And as a composer, in some ways he's even more American than Gershwin or Copland, because of the sheer variety of his talent, from jazz to musicals to concert music to operas to liturgical music of a personal Jewish kind. Boston-born of religious Jewish parents, the young Lenny graduated from Harvard in 1939. He was already a prodigious pianist, and he studied conducting with Fritz Reiner and Serge Koussevitzky. Aaron Copland was another one who made a great impression on the young Lenny.
I had fallen in love with the recording he had made of his piano variations. It seemed so stark and prophetic and unlike anything else that I knew. And when the moment came when I met Aaron Copland, it was his birthday, there was a party to which I was invited, and in the course of it, I was invited to play the piano, and I played his variations for him, which astonished him, because he didn't know that young people, hicks, provincials from Boston, could play his very difficult piano variations at parties. Anyway, we remained lifelong friends from that day to this. He would play me new pieces before they were finished. That was very flattering. I think I was the first one to play Billy the Kid with him in his four-hand arrangement. I even feel I've assisted in some of his writings. There are about 16 bars in Rodeo, his ballet Rodeo, which I didn't exactly write, but arranged. I'm very proud of that. He said, you do this. You know how to make a barrel house piano sound like that.
Where Bernstein's own compositions are concerned, public and critics agree to prefer his cinema, ballet and Broadway style to his concert and operatic one. Born way back in 1896, critic and composer Virgil Thompson crystallises in his typically sharp way a generally accepted view of his younger colleague.
As a composer of serious music, there's nothing wrong with it. The popular music, however, or the popular format is one where it always seems to me he is the most at home and the most natural. His popular music is of a quite unusual intellectual content, based on and quite evidently thorough acquaintance with and no hesitation about imitating the music of Darius Milhaud and Igor Stravinsky. Popular music seldom has that high an intellectual substratum.
On the Town, Candide, Wonderful Town, West Side Story, and the ballets, too, have this substratum Virgil Thompson was talking about, plus a superstratum of warmth, brilliance, and idiosyncratic tunes. Robert Cushman is a great expert on American musicals, so I asked him what he considers Bernstein has brought to the popular theatre.
I think primarily a great mastery of pastiche. I don't think he's a great original melodist. And oddly enough, the score of his that most people are most familiar with, West Side Story, is the one I would rate lowest. I think it's when Bernstein tries to find his own voice, especially when it's a romantic voice, I think it's where he falls down. I actually think that songs like Maria and One Hand, One Heart, and to a lesser extent Tonight, are awfully soapy, or soupy, not melodically very strong. I suppose they're really in the Rodgers and Hammerstein tradition and not as good as the best of the Rodgers and Hammerstein songs. I think what's good about West Side Story is the jazzy or Stravinskian mixture of the two music, for mainly for the dance sequences, for songs like Cool and The Rumble. It's when he actually gets to grips with the Romeo and Juliet story that I think the score begins to decline. On the other hand, it is an awfully effective show in the theatre.
As a television director, Humphrey Burton has worked with our musical Leonardo a lot. Humphrey not only knows the man well, he knows the whole gamut of his compositions. So, which of Bernstein's musicals would he single out?
Candide, first and foremost. I think Candide is the great light opera of the 20th century. Largely misunderstood. I must say also Bernstein himself hasn't done the best by it by allowing different versions to emerge, one for small orchestra, one with different lyrics. The original Lillian Hellman lyrics were, to my mind, better, or the original Lillian Hellman book was, to my mind, better than the subsequent version which Hal Prince fashioned. But I find Candide such a joy. It's eclectic, of course it is. It's what he called a visiting card, a Valentine to the entire history of Western music. But from Gilbert and Sullivan and Offenbach right down to his own time, Candide has me dancing in the streets.
It really is a spoof opera, which glories in its own artificiality. It was the cult musical of all time, using that phrase to mean a show that runs a short time, loses a lot of money, has a lot of admirers, and over the years sells a lot of records. If you listen to go back to the original recording, and you listen to a rollicking number like What's the Use, which is some Offenbach parody with very biting lyrics by the poet Richard Wilbur, I think that number was actually cut out of the revival, but it's one of the high points of the original production, to judge from the record.
I have always been wily and clever at deceiving and swindling and such, and I feel just as clever as ever, but I seem to be losing my touch. Oh, I'm losing my touch. Yes, I'm clever, but where does it get me? My employer gets all of my day. All I get is my daily spaghetti, while the gorgeous don't travel again. What's the use? There's no profit in cheating. It's
is no use in this jib joint. Not a sou have I made on her yet. And the one thing that pays in this clip joint is my fraudulent game of roulette, is my game of roulette.
But I have to pay so much protection to the chief of police and his men,
that each day when he makes his collection, I'm a poor man all over again. What's the use? What's the use of dishonest endeavor and being so clever? It's wrong, oh, so wrong, if you just have to pass it on.
So, is there anything in music that this man Bernstein cannot do? Apparently not. His illustrated lectures on music drew high praise even from those who waft faint damns at his music. His televised series of young people's concerts drew plaudits from Virgil Thompson.
His ability to explain the meaning of classical music is the most remarkable I've ever encountered. His essays about music, even those written when he was very, very young in school and college, are penetrating and convincing. His, originally a speech, now published as an essay, explaining Beethoven's Fifth Symphony is absolutely remarkable and first class. And I wasn't alone to think that. As a matter of fact, Eugene Ormandy made that remark to me at the time of the broadcast because he had heard it on the air.
We already know almost too well the opening bars of this symphony. Now, once Beethoven had made this strong initial statement, what then? How does he go on to develop it? He does it like this. But here is a discarded sketch, which is also a direct and immediate development of the theme. Not very good and not very bad, taken all by itself. But it is a good logical development of the opening figure. Now, what would the music sound like if Beethoven had used this sketch as the immediate development of his theme? We can find out by simply putting the sketch back into the symphony, and it will sound like this. It does make a difference, doesn't it? Not only because it sounds wrong to our ears, which are used to the version we know, but also because of the nature of the music itself. It is so symmetrical that it seems static. It doesn't seem to want to go anywhere, and that is fatal at the outset of a symphonic journey. It doesn't build, and Beethoven was first and foremost a builder.
Bernstein as teacher and conductor, too. In 1943, he took superbly his chance for a breakthrough as a conductor when he deputized at short notice for Bruno Walter in a New York concert that just happened to be broadcast nationwide. He was only 24. He directed the American premiere of Peter Grimes, the opera by Benjamin Britten. He conducted for Callas at La Scala, Milan. He was the first American-born conductor of the New York Philharmonic Orchestra, 1957 to 1969. He guest conducted the world over, but particularly with the Israel Philharmonic, the London Symphony, and the Vienna Philharmonic. From the 1960s onwards, he was America's answer to Europe's von Karajan, a superstar, in fact. Magisterial Virgil Thompson has seen all the great time beaters. Does he have reservations about Bernstein?
The conducting work is standard international genius type. Natural and well prepared in all the best traditions, you know. After all, a really bright boy with plenty of lessons from Fritz Reiner and Serge Koussevitzky can go quite a long way in that business.
In fact, there was one equally great influence in my life who was not my teacher, and that was Mitropoulos. Dimitri Mitropoulos, this great Greek conductor, was the person who talked me into being a conductor. He was one of these mystical people who looked at you with these electric blue eyes and said, you must be a conductor, and this great ascetic bald head, and you believed him. And I had heard him conduct long before I ever heard Koussevitzky or knew Koussevitzky or Reiner. So that when I did become a conductor, I think, for example, the fact that I never used a baton for the first 15 years of my conducting life is due directly to the fact that he didn't use a baton. The choice of repertoire was very much influenced by him. He's the only one I ever heard play the C-sharp minor quartet of Beethoven, for example, with all the strings, full strings of an orchestra. And that's something that I have done and recorded with the Vienna Philharmonic. In fact, it's my favorite record that I've ever made.
Beethoven, Opus 131, Bernstein following in Mitropoulos' footsteps. Except that Mitropoulos' footwork at concerts was restrained, although he danced and leapt about at rehearsals. Bernstein's choribantics do not stop at the concerts, they increase. Some people are not at all put off by this, especially a friend and colleague who wrote the lyrics for West Side Story, Stephen Sondheim.
The people who object to Lenny's dancing around on the podium, I think, are... They just object to that style. But he is a very exuberant fellow. I haven't seen a lot of him in the last few years, but he is, by nature, an enthusiast and an exuberant man. He also has many moments of introspection and gloom, because he's also a serious fellow, but you can see that in his conducting, too. He doesn't dance through the slow movements.
He has a tendency toward display and choreographic posing when conducting in public. It doesn't interfere with the music, but it does sometimes interfere a little bit with the visual aspect. But I've always noticed that when he gets into a theater pit or an opera pit, all that disappears because there's nobody to look at it or admire it, and he becomes perfectly straightforward in his motions and conducting gestures. He's awfully good, as a matter of fact, in the theater. I've heard him conduct wonderful performances.
Tristan and Isolde and Leonard. Bernstein is an insatiable worker in private and in public, and he's such a charismatic figure that even a political faux pas or two have been forgiven. But what is he like to work with?
He knows his own worth, of course, but he's not in the least bit odious, as some composers and some conductors are. Contrary to the myth that he has to surround himself with jet-setters and so on, and he does perhaps allow too much of that sort of backstage, you have to stand in line for 20 minutes to get near him, that kind of thing. But he knows also that there are a lot of young people who do value, if we're talking about getting autographs, who do value the personal contact which he's providing in that way. There's a bit of a Bernstein circus, as I'm saying, but at the centre of it, I don't think that Bernstein is a sort of overblown character, and I do know him quite well.
His persona, it seems to me, exactly the same kinds of rich and extreme moods that he shows on the stand, plus passion, which is something he always shows on the podium and in music. Music is his passion, but he's passionate about many things, I think, in life, family, religion, literature. He's an enthusiast. Also, it is true that one-to-one Lenny is at his best, which is true, incidentally, of most of us. In a room full of people where he has a sense of his celebrity, then the extremes become more extreme. But all the warmth is very, very, very clear, and all the effusiveness is very clear, and the enthusiasm, which is genuine, becomes even clearer the more you are alone with him or the fewer people there are around.
Bernstein's a genuinely warm person, and he is a genuinely humanist person who wishes to change society, to improve society, to speak out against evil as he sees it. At the same time, he is perhaps a little naive sometimes, or was a little naive. There was the famous occasion 20 years ago when Tom Wolfe wrote that attack on Bernstein and his friends when they gave house room and a party to the radicals. The piece was entitled Radical Chic, as I recall, and it was involving lots of support for extreme left-wing agitators in the comfortable surroundings of the Bernstein Park Avenue flat at that time. I think Lenny learnt a good deal from the criticism which Tom Wolfe's piece incorporated. He is still a man who's prepared to wear his heart on his sleeve.
If what you're getting at is it an artist's business to stick his nose into fields other than his art, so he just stay home and mind his business, I think that that's up to the individual artist. I mean, it's the way I live in the world. I live by participating. I don't participate in a synagogue congregation, but I participate in the world of my fellow citizens, and I feel strongly about them and compassionately about them, and therefore I can't exempt myself from the struggle to improve the lot of my fellow human beings.
Does Bernstein sound to you like a man who never smiles? Not at all, says Sondheim.
Oh, terrific sense of humor. You can hear it in his music. He's very into puns, very into language, and so am I. And he has a good bitchy streak in him. He is a sharp observer. Mostly it's his articulateness and readiness to laugh. He is an easy and terrific audience.
He's got a good Jewish showbiz sense of humor. And he has a great joy and sense of fun about words, as well as about happenings. He's not a raconteur in the way that some great men are, but he is nevertheless able to savor the wit in all sorts of situations. What he's not so good at is, as it were, telling jokes against himself.
It all adds up to phenomenal gifts, plus a full life lived to the full. Something like genius in the popular theatre, and as a conductor of a wide range of composers, from Haydn, Beethoven, Schumann, Wagner, Mahler, through to Shostakovich, Britten, and most of his American colleagues, Harris, Sessions, Copland. His piano concerto records of Ravel, Gershwin, Shostakovich, faultless. As a straight composer, perhaps more misses than hits, but surely the Chichester Psalms will live, and Songfest, and certainly the Serenade with violin solo, with which we'll end after a last word from Leonard Bernstein himself. Has life been good to him?
More than. By my standards, I've had 5 or 6 or 7 lifetimes already, I think I've been luckier than most people I know. I'm very, very grateful for my life, of my lives. And I've been blessed in an extraordinary way. What more can I say? In other words, you know, if I were to die tomorrow, I wouldn't have any complaints. But I hope I won't.